While the Marvel Cinematic Universe and the comics do have their fair share of differences, most of them good and a few bad, there have been some rare times where we got to see some MCU scenes on the big screen that were taken straight from the pages of the comic books, and they looked absolutely glorious. It's happened more often than you think, so today, that's exactly what we're going to be looking at. While in the comic books, Loki had to wait a really long time to take Odin's throne and act as the King of Asgard, but didn't have to wait nearly as long in the movies. In fact, director Kenneth Branagh didn't waste any time with Loki in the movie Thor. In typical Loki fashion, the God of Thunder's adopted brother came up with a master plan that would destroy the family and end up with him sitting on the throne of Asgard, and it didn't take long for his plan to come to fruition, even if it was only briefly. Thor ended up getting banished from Asgard after restarting a war with the frost giants of the Jotunheim, and Odin entered his patented deep sleep, known as Odin's sleep, to recharge his Odin force. All of this allowed the God of Mischief to take over as the King of Asgard for a short time. It took a much longer time for the trickster to become the King of Asgard in the comics. Loki always wanted to rule over Asgard and finally got the chance in 2004's Loki miniseries. Considering he was introduced in the comics in 1962, it was well worth the wait for him. Ah, Loki. You gotta give it to Loki. He's nothing if not persistent. Anyone who's associated with Johann Schmidt, aka Red Skull, is a bad dude, and Arnim Zola's no different. We thought we saw the last of him after Captain America the First Avenger, but oh, were we wrong. Arnim Zola was a lead scientist for Hydra from a different time period, but that didn't stop the Russo brothers from tearing a page out of the Marvel comic books. Just when we thought we were done with Arnim Zola, he came back, but in a different form. In the movie, we learn that shortly after World War II, S.H.I.E.L.D. took Zola in, which unsurprisingly turned out to be a terrible decision, as he secretly rebuilt Hydra from within the organization. After being confronted with certain death in the 70s, Zola decided, you know what, I'm a super smart scientist, so why don't I just transfer my mind into a computer? This whole idea of Zola being a computer started in the comics. Working as a scientist for the Nazis, he conducted plenty of awful experiments on innocent people, and during one of these experiments, he got a terrible infection, which forced him to transfer his mind into a computer. He's still a very mean computer, though. If there's one thing we know about the Hulk, it's that he likes to smash things. Whether they're friend or foe, the Hulk has gotten into plenty of fights in the comics and the MCU, sometimes even going toe-to-toe with his fellow Avengers. In fact, we've already seen this happen multiple times in the MCU. Whether it's because he's under some kind of mind control or not, which is often the case for some reason, the Hulk gets incredibly angry. Trust us, you don't like him when he's angry, and starts getting into it with other superheroes. One of the most incredible scenes in the MCU that paid homage to a certain Hulk versus Avengers moment from the comics happened in the Avengers. In the movie, it was Loki once again up to his old tricks. His actions caused Bruce Banner to transform into the Hulk while aboard a S.H.I.E.L.D. helicarrier. This led to the famous scene where we see Hulk and Thor battle it out. This scene closely resembles an event that happened when the Avengers got together for the first time in the comics. Loki manipulated both Hulk and Thor to fight each other, typical Loki, but they later teamed up and took down the God of Mischief. While Iron Man 3 gets a lot of hate for many reasons, mainly because of the stunt Marvel Studios pulled with the whole Mandarin thing since it wasn't the real Mandarin we know and love from the comic books, it did have its fair share of awesome and memorable moments. One of these incredibly cool moments was when we saw all of Tony Stark's Iron Man suits lined up. We were freaking out when we saw this scene, you know, like any crazy comic book fan would. Near the end of the film, we even got to see these suits in action, being controlled by Jarvis, which if you didn't know, stands for just another rather very intelligent system, we saw a small army of these Iron Man suits used to help Tony Stark take down Aldrich Killian. We've also seen many of Tony's Iron Man suits in the comics, with the most memorable shot being from Ultimate Spider-Man issue number 153, where Iron Man gives Spider-Man a full house tour. The two-page spread shows us all the suits Tony Stark has created from two completely different eras of Iron Man's long history in the comic books. Peter Parker had his jaw on the floor the whole time, just like we did reading the issue. Captain America Civil War was a Captain America movie, but it was pretty much an Avengers movie when you think about it. With all the heroes that appeared in the film, it definitely felt like an Avengers movie to us. Anyway, unsurprisingly, there were plenty of scenes taken from the comics that were nearly replicated in Civil War, since there was a very similar storyline of the same name in the comics, but the scene where Ant-Man decided to hitch a ride on one of Hawkeye's arrows is arguably one that stood out the most for longtime comic book fans. In fact, the shot of Ant-Man lying prone on top of one of Hawkeye's arrows as the archer takes aim was taken directly from the cover of the Avengers issue 223, but in the comics, they do battle with the Taskmaster, and as we're sure you know, in the movie, they're teaming up with Captain America to try and take down Team Iron Man. The fight in the comics ends with Hawkeye launching Ant-Man on one of his arrows so the little guy could disable Taskmaster's weapon. The same tactic was used in Civil War, where we saw Ant-Man disable Iron Man's suit from the inside. Hey, if it works, it works. If you read the Civil War comics, then you'll know that there's a few differences between it and the storyline that we saw in Captain America's Civil War. Now, in the comics, some of the heroes taking part in the Civil War are different, and the storyline itself is much more dark. But in the MCU, the Russo brothers did an incredible job at turning this edgy miniseries into a fun yet serious film for Marvel Studios. It wasn't easy to adapt it into a PG film, but the Russo brothers did a great job. The comic event was started by a villain known as Nitro, who blows himself up along with a nearby school. Yeah, we weren't lying when we said it was dark. Not too long after the explosion, one of the victim's mothers confronts Tony Stark. She lets him know that if superheroes were held to be accountable for their actions, tragic events like these wouldn't happen nearly as often, which pushed a guilt-ridden Stark to start clashing with his fellow Avengers. During Captain America: Civil War, we see a similar scene where a woman confronts Tony to talk about her son who passed away. Now, just like in the comics, she convinced Tony that this accident wouldn't have happened if superheroes were held accountable by their government. Now let's talk about the most incredible scene in Captain America: Civil War that was taken straight from the comics. Civil War gave us all we could ask for in a rare superhero versus superhero movie. Like we said earlier, it did a great job of loosely adapting the comic event and turning it into an event that would shape the future of the MCU at the time. We mentioned that some of the superheroes who took part in the Civil War miniseries in the comics were different, but the two leaders didn't change. This led to an incredible final act where we got to see two heavyweights in Captain America and Iron Man go at it. The events that led up to this battle differ between the comics and the movie, but in the end, the result is the exact same. Captain America and Iron Man beat each other to a pulp in both, and there's a certain scene in the movie that nearly replicates a shot in the comics. It's that close-up shot where Cap's blocking Iron Man's blasters with that iconic vibranium shield. Neither of these superheroes gave up the fight, which eventually led to a rift in their relationship that's still present as we head into Avengers Endgame. Switching gears to Spider-Man Homecoming, this movie was one of the biggest surprises in the MCU in 2017. It had the youngest cast of characters that we've ever had in the MCU, which included Ned Leeds, who pretty much stole the show, or movie in this case. He has the same name as the classic comic book character from Spider-Man's early days, but he's actually based on Gonkei Lee, who's the best friend of Miles Morales. You know, the version of Spidey we got to see in Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. The scene where Ned learned about Peter Parker's powers is similar to how Gonkei learned about Miles in the comics. They both feature one of Spider-Man's most hilarious friends and the destruction of an artistic masterpiece made out of Legos. In Homecoming, we see Peter return to his room wearing his Spider-Man costume, and is surprised to see Ned Leeds sitting at the side of his bed holding a Lego Death Star. Once Ned takes one look at Peter, it falls out of his hands and all the Legos come loose. In the comics, it plays out a little differently. Miles walked into Gonkei's room to purposely show off his new powers, which caused his friend to drop his Lego creation like it's hot. Spider-Man Homecoming was such a good movie because it made not one, but two references to the comics. Okay, that's not the only reason why it was so good, but it's definitely one of them. It's also because we got a great mix of the modern teenager Spider-Man and the classic Peter Parker. It was the best of both worlds, and they even paid homage to an all-time classic Spider-Man moment from the comics. In the final act of Homecoming, Spider-Man finds himself buried underneath some rubble with what seems like no way out. He has no one to help him out, and this would be the end of the road for any normal human. But Peter uses all the strength he has inside him to pick himself up. It was a crazy moment to see in the film, and it was a reference to a moment from The Amazing Spider-Man issue number 33. In the comic book, Dr. Octopus stole the cure for Aunt May's life-threatening illness. With the life of someone he loves at stake, Spider-Man tries to retrieve the cure, but gets caught underneath a bunch of rubble, using the power inside him to find a way out. They're both incredible and epic moments that really made us believe there's nothing Spider-Man can't do. Another movie that made plenty of references to the source material was Thor: Ragnarok. After the disappointment that was Thor: The Dark World, Ragnarok was a great change of pace and a much-needed return to quality that the Thor movies desperately needed. It was filled with intriguing storylines from the past two decades in the comic books, with the most notable influences being Ragnarok, obviously, the unworthy Thor, and Planet Hulk. Just like in the movie, the storyline behind Planet Hulk involved the Hulk getting stranded on an unknown planet and then being forced to fight against others in some kind of gladiatorial games. The main difference is that in the comics, Thor's nowhere to be seen on this alien planet. Instead, it revolves around the Hulk trying to overthrow the planet's emperor, who's known as the Red King. As you know, the story plays out quite differently in the movie. There we see Hulk in full gladiator garb as he fights against the God of Thunder. There's no mention of the Red King, and the Hulk's merely a secondary character to Thor and his ongoing concerns about Ragnarok. But we honestly can't complain too much, because the best part about Planet Hulk was getting to see Gladiator Hulk in the first place. In Thor: Ragnarok, we got to see it all. It had comedy, absurdism, and even plenty of epic moments that had us hanging onto the edge of our seat. There's no doubt that it was one of the MCU's funniest films, up there with Ant-Man and Ant-Man and the Wasp, but it wasn't all fun and games. This film was chock full of both dramatic and unforgettable moments. It's safe to say we really liked this movie. One of our favorite moments definitely had to be when the Executioner went out in a blaze of glory near the end of the film. Comic book fans immediately realized that this scene reminded them of something that happened in Walt Simpson's The Mighty Thor issue 362, rightly titled The Death of the Executioner. It could not be closer to the truth. Just like in the movie, the Executioner charges into Hela's undead army, knowing very well what fate awaits him by doing so. He comes in guns blazing, literally, as he's shooting guns akimbo and does his best to fight the undead. Everything from the Executioner's enemy to the panel of him using a melee weapon to obliterate the undead army was used in Thor: Ragnarok to great effect. It was everything we could have asked for. Thor: Ragnarok took a huge risk, and it paid off tremendously. For starters, there was a huge change to the tone. Things got less serious, but at the same time, they kind of got more serious. We saw Thor lose an eye, and we saw the Executioner, as well as many other Asgardians, die in the film. Even Matt Damon made a cameo at one point, but the most shocking part of the movie definitely has to be that it actually followed through on the title's promise. What do we mean by that? Well, we got to experience the Ragnarok event. While the Ragnarok storyline in the comics is very similar to the one we saw in the movie, there are some differences. Surtur, a giant flame demon, played a huge role in the comics as well, destroying Asgard and killing off all of the Asgardians. That's right, Surtur killed every single one of them, including Thor and Loki. Hey, listen, the title of the comic didn't lie either, as they gave us total Ragnarok. There's no way they could have done the same thing in the movie, though, because we'd be lost without Thor and Loki. So Marvel Studios managed to keep things as fun as they could and keep those two alive. Black Panther was a massive hit that helped set the stage for Infinity War by introducing us to Wakanda. The movie was full of twists and turns, but the most shocking moment of the film had to be when Killmonger defeated T'Challa in the ritual duel to become the Black Panther. The two of them had this duel on top of the waterfall, so it didn't take long for us to realize that one of them was probably going to be thrown off of it. We just thought that it would be Killmonger because the bad guy always loses, but boy, were we wrong. Killmonger surprised us all and gained the upper hand before he yeeted T'Challa down the waterfall, establishing himself as the new king of Wakanda. This scene came straight from the comic book Jungle Action issue 6. In the comic, Killmonger's determined to sit on the throne of Wakanda, which led him to challenge the Black Panther at Warrior Falls. Now, just like in the movie, T'Challa fails to defeat Killmonger, and when it's all said and done, he finds himself at the bottom of a waterfall, barely alive. From there, the stories are different. In the comics, T'Challa's rescued by one of his American friends, but in the movie, he's found by the Jabari tribe. Among the scenery in Black Panther were some of the flora and fauna of Wakanda, but the most interesting animal that we got to see in the movie was definitely an armored rhino. In the final act of the movie, during the Dora Milaje's attempt to try and overthrow Killmonger's newly established government, Wakabi brings out the big guns and mounts a heavily armored rhino before aiming straight for the Dora Milaje. T'Challa interferes just in time, before things get even more out of hand than they already are, and we see the Black Panther body check a rhino. Yeah, that's right. He straight up body checked a rhino. Maybe a career as a hockey player in the NHL is in T'Challa's future? Nah, he's too busy doing more important things like, you know, saving Wakanda and the world at large. The scene was very similar to a moment in the comics, specifically one that happened in Jungle Action issue number 9. In the comic book, T'Challa has to save a child from a charging rhino, but the difference here was that the Black Panther relied on his understanding of the jungle to solve the problem instead of the brute force of his high vibranium enhanced suit. In both the comics and the movie, the beast was stopped in its tracks. Last but not least, we have a scene from one of the best movies of 2018, Avengers Infinity War. We were teased about this scene in the last trailer for Infinity War, and a similar scene was found in the actual movie. It provided us comic book fans with a very familiar scene. In the movie, we saw Ebony Maw, one of the members of Thanos' infamous Black Order, come to New York City to bargain with Doctor Strange, Wong, and Iron Man. He's come to take the precious Time Stone from Doctor Strange and give it to Thanos for his Infinity Gauntlet, but of course, things don't go as planned. Ebony Maw ends up torturing Doctor Strange, but it's still not enough to make him hand over the stone. At this point, he'd protect it with his life. And even if Maw went as far as to kill Doctor Strange, he still had Wong to deal with. The Russo brothers love to take scenes from the comics and adapt them to the big screen. In the comic book event Infinity, there's a scene where we see Maw torturing Doctor Strange, trying to force him into serving the Black Order. While the reason is different, it's clear where the Russo brothers got their inspiration from. And those were some MCU scenes taken straight from the Marvel comic books. Are any of these scenes your favorite in all of the MCU? Are there any scenes that we may have missed? Let us know in the comments section below, and don't forget to subscribe to CBR for more MCU content. Thanks for watching.